Okay, this is gonna be awesome. Right, here we go. Let's do a podcast. Time to talk some lighting. Right, hello everyone, and welcome to the Shootout Podcast. I'm your host Ross Baxter, and today is episode 31 of the series. Today's guest is Guillaume Deschamps Michel, a lighting artist at Ubisoft Barcelona. He's worked on so many awesome titles such as Assassin's Creed 3 Remastered, V Rally 4, and many more. How you doing, man? Thanks for coming on.
Hey man, I'm fine, and you?
I'm doing great. Really looking forward to this. As always on the podcast, I always try to bring on the best guests I possibly can, and we've got an awesome guest for you guys today. Like I said, we've got a lighting artist, and it's actually been the main trend, obviously, in the last few weeks, in which I've brought on a wide range of lighting artists. And it's great to get like everyone's different perspective and hear their story and their journey. As always, if you're new to the podcast, I always bring people from the creative industries, from all backgrounds, from concept art to environment art. You name it, the podcast pretty much covers it. The podcast is live on 9 other platforms alongside YouTube, such as Anchor, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Breaker, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Radio Public, and last but not least, we've got Stitcher. Obviously, the main thing is obviously you, the students. So it'd be great if you guys could share your art links in the comments below. And every week, I'll give a shout out to you guys on my social media platforms, and showcase your artwork on the podcast. However, with all that said, let's get right into the podcast. We've got Guillaume, I'm looking forward to this, man. Let's do this.
Yeah, let's go.
So, as always, man, yeah, it'd just be great to just tell us a wee bit about yourself. So, like, what you do, etc. And I guess what got you into art, maybe.
Yeah, sure. So, to begin everything, I had so after my high school diploma, it was in letters. In France, there is not that many university where you can learn 3D or game art. Well, back then. And it was quite tricky to find something because most of the private school are quite expensive, even if it's not as expensive as like US, for example. Here in France, I think it's like around 1 year is around 7,000
Yeah, that's quite meh.
euros. And you have like the average amount of years is like 4 year in school, and then you can find a job and everything. So it was quite tricky because also some of those diploma are not recognized by like the state or everything. So like making understand to your parent that this diploma is not recognized is quite tricky.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not always the easiest, is it?
So, well, after high school, I went to a private school called ESMA. It's localized in the south of France, but I know that they have like multiple schools now. I did like a fine art and art history update there for 1 year. So I learned how to draw the history, the art history and everything, English also. And then after that, I went to another school that is called Objective 3D. That is a school where you have VFX cursus, but also game art. It's in 3 years. And back then, I think I went like 2.5 years because the last year is about creating like a full demo for a game in a team.
Oh wow, right, okay, yeah.
And I think it was the first year that did this, that at the end, like basically you have six group of 4 people. During 6 months, you will do like a concept for your game. Then you have a jury with people from the industry. So as we were in Montpellier, it was people from Ubisoft Montpellier and everything. They vote for the best project, and then the last 6 months, you will develop this project with the whole class together.
Oh, awesome. Nice one.
So yeah, it was quite I really like this thing.
Yeah.
And In the last year, I had the opportunity to go in an internship after the first 6 months. So I did the pre-production and everything for this game, and then I went in my first job. And this first job was at Cyanide. So I was intern environment artist for 6 months, and I had the opportunity to work on games such as like Styx, Master of Shadows, and Blood Bowl 2. It was like quite a big experience for me because, I mean, the first time you go out of school and like really work for a studio is always like a big thing.
Yeah, it's like it's crazy. It's like obviously we all have our different sort of like how can I say it, like our own little different paths and stories and stuff. And every time when we obviously, like obviously we all go for that one job, like we're all wanting like a job and stuff. And getting that first job is like, oh my God, it's so good, isn't it? It's so rewarding. I'm pretty sure it's quite daunting as well. Like you'd agree, maybe it's a wee bit, you get a wee bit nervous. But like overall though, it's I'm pretty sure it's always like just pure excitement, because at the end of the day, it's like we're all artists at the end of the day, whether it's game art you're interested in or like film. So I bet you like you're loving it.
The thing also is that when you start your first job, it's always also stressful to see if you are up to date to everything, see how people are working, see if your training at school was good. It's a really good way to see if like you are ready to do it.
It's also the scary thing, because it's like when you're getting taught, because you naturally have this kind of, I what's the best word? It's like you kind of naturally feel that, like say you got to your final year, and basically you're kind of like, right, I've got through my course, I've got the knowledge, but you can only tell if you've got the right knowledge once you've actually got that first job, like you're saying. So it's sometimes it can be very, I don't know, a wake up call until you actually start the job. But it's just crazy, because it's no, because it's great hearing like your side of things in terms of like, because obviously like you've went to a few educations as well. It's not just like you've went to one place, like because that's similar to me, so that's really cool. Because so I went to two places, two colleges first before I went to university. In Scotland and UK we have a weird thing, so basically we have colleges and university. I'm not sure if it's the same in France, but it's like they're slightly different in terms of like level, if that makes sense.
It makes sense.
So no, but that's awesome. So, because we can really like talk about a lot of different things from that, like your own perspective, because you have that different story to tell, basically. So that's great. So as always, man, I always kind of tailor the podcast around the four kind of main questions, basically. And but there's some really awesome questions I want to ask. And also, when it comes to your art in general, like there's one particular piece that I'm just like, dude, how did you make that? Please tell me. It's the, do you know the snow piece, the what's it called, the snowy mountains one, like I think, I'm not sure, is it an old piece you made? Because it's, I still like, I think that looks so sick.
Thank you. It's quite an old one, I think, actually.
Well, it's that one. There's like so many different pieces. So there's one of your Assassin's Creed pieces, the snowy piece, and then the sunset one. It's just like this, I think it's literally just called sunset. And like the great thing about, I think it's like the great thing and like the hard thing for lighting artists. I guess it kind of applies to kind of all areas, but it's like obviously like that range is important, and like your portfolio literally highlights everything. So it's amazing.
Well, the thing is that I think the most important thing to think about when you are anything in the industry, like environment or lighting or modeler, character artist, is to train, because the thing is that in school, for example, you will like right now it's not it's not the case, but back when I was in school, for example, I didn't have any class about lighting, character art, anything like this, because the school was mainly focused on the environment. And this is because the speakers, the people that you call to teach in the school, character, it was, how you say this, the people that can really bring you something in character art was all in Canada or in the US, and it's really hard to make them come in France, for example.
Right.
And yeah, the thing is that sometimes you have to learn everything from yourself. And the main important thing is to train every time, like train.
Like just like nonstop, you have to, like that's the thing. So that's the interesting thing, obviously, when it comes to to France, I guess. So obviously, I'm not from France and stuff, but I don't know much about the system. But if there's anyone who's listening, who is from France, today you're going to be getting great insight about not only just like the learning curve in France, but hearing how like there's so many opportunities for you to take advantage of, and like to never stop chasing the dream. Like just keep working on your craft. It doesn't matter where you're from, just keep working at it. I've got one interesting question just about France. Like, so what would you, so you're saying there about obviously like the teaching and stuff and that, and there's not many schools. Is there any sort of main school in France that you know of?
Well, I speak in a French school that is called New Edge.
Okay.
It's a Parisian school, and you have courses like VFX and game art. And the really good thing, well, I say this, it's not because I'm work there.
I believe you, man. I believe you.
I mean, the good thing in this school, and what I like about this, is that they work really hard to bring people from the industry that are working right now in games to the school. So you see the people, you can talk with them, and they teach you everything they know. And this is the best thing. Like,
yeah.
For example, you have Marco Plouf from Chaos Mason that comes to teach ZBrush to students and everything. Like, it's crazy skills, people.
Yeah.
And I think this is the. I mean, it should be like this every time. Like,
yeah, definitely.
If you teach something, you have to bring people that are working right now in the industry, so you can teach from the best people.
That's like. I'm really glad you said that, because I never really thought about it. So obviously a lot of places take people from, like, they have thing I bring up very common is guest speakers, and I understand the concept behind guest speakers, and I understand that obviously not everybody has the time to, how could I say it, to maybe stay for a wee bit. Or teach, like one of the guys who's kind of like mentored me over the years, he went out to Denmark to teach for like a week, and in that week he was teaching character art, and like the students has never learned so much in their life, because it was crazy, if you know what I mean. And the fact that that course that you're at teaching and stuff and so forth, like that would be like, if I had to like summarize like student education for the university side of things, that's the way it should kind of be, like you're saying.
Yeah.
Because it's just, I don't know, it's just, I still think there's too much, like I understand the importance of research, and research is important, and I understand like universities is very kind of, how could I describe it? Orientated around obviously finding yourself, would you agree? Like, I guess, like, identity, basically.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that sometimes in university you have teachers that are here the full year and here with you, and I mean they know a lot of stuff, of course, but you also have to get in touch with real people from the industry, like that are working right now. I think this is the best thing.
It's yeah, best sort of way to do it.
Because they can teach you new stuff that is coming out. They can bring you the knowledge, what they've gone through and everything, and it's really the best.
What would you like? Obviously, I normally always ask the same four questions, but I like to make things up, like, I like to change it up a wee bit. So, like normally, I always say, like, what do you wish when you were studying and stuff? But was there anything, I guess, like when you were studying that, like, obviously you said you never got the chance to get taught lighting. Is there anything you like lighting you thought would have been really beneficial? Like, what would you like to maybe get taught?
Yeah, the main thing that I wish I had is class about compositing, also color theory, like the main topics. Like, basically, if you are an environment artist or a lighting artist, the really important part is how you present your work. Mm-hmm. Like, it's crazy the amount of students that I see that to present their environment, that is, the environment is really good, but they choose like the weirdest camera angle ever.
Yeah.
And you're like, explain them, like, you have to put everything, like, you have to sell yourself. So you have to sell your work. And it's really important to know how to take good screenshot, good composition, good color and everything. And this is what I wish I had when I was in school.
Yeah, it's like the whole whole sort of like getting a better story across as well and stuff. Like, it's mental because there's like so many, like, that's why I love lighting art, because like there's so much things you can do with it, and I think still so many students need to take more advantage of it, because like there's like you said, like, you just nailed it there. Like, there's so much things that people should be doing to like really to sell it better. Just wondering, so like, what got you into lighting art? Like, was it environment art you did originally?
Well, the lighting art, it was because after Cyanide, where I was an intern, I went, like, I had a really struggle to find my next job in the industry. And I almost quit everything to do something else.
Oh, right, wow.
Because it's really hard, like... Yeah. When you finish your internship and they do not keep you in the team, it's really hard to find something else. Because also, well, I finished my internship in July, and during the summer it's really hard to find something. Mm-hmm. And then I found a job as 3D artist in an ArtV studio in Paris. And this is where, like, everything blows up. It was completely crazy to learn about lighting and everything in Unreal, because I knew some stuff, but like, this is where I learned everything about lighting. Like, ArchViz is the best way I learned lighting.
Awesome,
because
that's cool.
You have to present something that is like clean and really well done with the shadows and everything. So yeah, I learned a lot in this.
That's where it all clicked. That's when you were like, here we go.
yeah, and the thing is that when you find something that it suits for you, like, I really like my job, I really like what I'm doing, and it's like, you can work hours without saying I'm bored of this, and this is the most important.
Definitely. Like, I'm really happy you said that, and I like the fact that you said about that you brought up, like, it was a struggle, if you know what I mean, like, it was hard, and like, that's the main point to get from, well, it's the two points he said there, is, like, he found what his passion was, like, he found what clicked for him, and then he also, like, you also, you persevered, you kept going through it, and, like, I get, like, a lot of artists, if you're listening right now, maybe you're going through a certain moment that it's, maybe you're, like, I'm not getting, like, nobody's biting, maybe I'm not getting any job interest, you just have to keep working on it.
Yeah, never give up. This is the thing that I learned. It's like, never give up. If you continue to train, if you learn stuff, it will work one day.
What's your so obviously continuing like the whole sort of theme on like lighting and stuff, and it'd be really cool to maybe go into depth about lighting, if you're okay with that. It'd be awesome to talk about lighting.
Yeah, sure.
So obviously, like, there's so many questions artists kind of ask all the time, whether it's like, what type of lighting maybe do you recommend me to learn and stuff. Like, there's all these different questions. There's a few things I was just wondering, like, is there any like common trends that you think really like kind of like are like noticeable to you that's maybe sell a lighting artist?
You mean
like
to
like to maybe like any like main sort of like, I guess, portfolio pieces to maybe do, or is there anything that's like what stands out to like what makes you stand out as a lighting artist? Sorry, I was so overcomplicating that.
No worries, man. I think the like for the portfolio, the main thing is to show that you understand how lighting works. Like, do not burn everything in your picture. Do not try to lit everything. I think Onion was speaking about this in your podcast. But do not try to lit the entire environment. Like, sometimes you have to create like this feeling of mystery in your piece, in your environment. And do not, the main thing is have a good color theory knowledge, so you can, you know which color works with another one. Have a good sense of general lighting, like general intensity in your scene. Do not try to lit everything. And then I think like compositing, and that will be really good for now.
That's the
like the rest. Yeah, the rest you can learn this like every day at work. And this is also a thing, like even today, like as an artist, you will never stop learning. And even today, like, I'm not the best in compositing, I'm not the best in lighting and everything, but I always learn every time, every day, by, I don't know, looking at other artists' work, looking at photography and everything. And this is the main also interest of this job, is to keep learning every day. Like, you never stop learning.
Definitely. Like observation is it's so crucial. Like, getting new reference, getting inspired by new things. Like, you mentioned compositing and stuff. Is like, what software do you use for compositing? Or like learning, or even if it's not compositing, but just like learning composition and stuff. Like what's your kind of go-to for like the software side of things, I guess?
Well, I have different medium for this. I have a lot of books here, for example. Teaching you photography and how to how to improve in photography. I think this is quite important also, like the photography part. And the main medium I use and I like to use is books. I have quite a lot of books.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And after that, I think, I mean, it's also about feeling. Like, you have to, what I like to do is put a camera in my scene, adjust the like the different settings of my camera, and then I walk, like I just go through my scene and I try to find some interesting place or angles. And when I found it, I redo the same. I do 3 or 4 of them. I let 1, 2, 3 days go. And then I go back to my scene, watch again the angle, and I delete the one that I don't like and keep the one that I like.
That's a great one, because like, it's these small things that, like, so everyone who's tuning in, make sure, like, one of the main things there is, like, make sure to give yourself the time to, like, refresh your mind. And because that's the thing, is like I get it, like, we all want to, like, keep working on something, but it's like it causes so much problems if you don't like doing your, when you're just like doing an art piece and you're like, I can't see the obvious,
and
like your mind just gets fried, you're just like, what's looking wrong here? But you just need to like step back and just like approach it from a different angle, like you're saying.
No, I was saying letting 1 or 2 days go is the best thing you can do.
Yeah, no, that's great, because like when it comes to like any art piece in general, like there's so many different things, like so many different methods, and I think personally the most important one is just rest, and so many people underestimate it at times. Like speaking on like lighting and stuff. This is a question that I wanted to ask. Like I just came out of maybe sounds an obvious question to ask, but for some reason it just came to my mind last night when I was like thinking about what to ask, and I was like, what's the hardest thing about being a lighting artist? Like what kind of comes to your mind that's just like, yeah, that's a hard part. Like that's difficult. That's like a fired a hard question.
Yeah, it's really a hard question, but
sorry, I just wanted to see what you think. There's no pressure whatsoever. Just that if anything does come to mind.
No worries, man. I think the biggest challenge is to find something new to tell through lighting.
Yeah.
For example, if you do like a let's say a forest in the like the sunset forest, for example, like in the golden hour and everything. The really hard part is to find something else to do because I still have this in mind, and I want to go deeper in this, and like I cannot do the same because it's not good after, and you have always to find something new to. Like a new story to tell and everything. This is, I think, for me the hardest part.
Oh, that's a good one because it's the whole topic of change. If you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And like varying things up. Like for example, like my old piece. I love hard surface modeling, but my new project is currently all foliage. just so you know. I've spent too long doing that type of modeling. I need to just get my mind away from that. it's so important. It's just because it's like you said. It's like you need to kind of you need to get that kind of like fire going again.
Yeah.
As in like that new flavor, and if you keep doing like a lot of artists have this habit of doing the same things, and it's a I understand it, but I think it's personally all just because they're maybe either afraid or they're too much, like they're trapped in the comfort zone. So it's one of those kind of, it's getting a balance.
Also, I just want to add that it's also in this case that where you, let's say that you finish the work and you begin to think of a new one. And this is where going on ArtStation, going on Pinterest, on Flickr, looking different photography, looking different works, it will bring you new idea. And this is what I really like to do. Like when I finish something, I always take 3-4 days off and go back to it to see if I will change something or not. And then I always feed my eyes with something. Like this is the important stuff also for environment and lighting. Like always feed your eyes with new content, new photos, new work from another artist, and everything is really important.
Awesome, because I don't know. It's just like, for example, like you're saying, it's like you need, like you just need to like I know I'm keep repeating myself, but it's so crucial because at the end of the day, it's like when it comes to getting into the industry, getting a job, you want to not only show range, you not only want to show that obviously like obviously you can do different things, but you want to highlight the passion that in your artwork, and the best way to do it is by changing things up and getting making fresh ideas, because there's so many Like I'm pretty sure you agree, there's so many portfolios that kind of are a bit maybe generic, like, or they're quite, I guess cliche is the word, but it's like there's so many things that it's nice for like a recruiter to see something different.
Yeah, sure.
sorry, I keep cutting you off. Sorry, everyone's wondering. So when it comes to podcasts, like one of the hardest things is when it comes to connection and stuff is because like the camera. So it's always so funny because every time I do a podcast, it's like most people don't have a camera, so I'm just like, right, when are you going to speak?
No worries, man. just I was Onion was talking also about this. I think don't put like everything in your, like, not everything, but try to filter your portfolio for the job you applied on. Always put your best piece. It's not a big deal if there is like three pieces, two pieces in your portfolio. Like, if those ones are like killer work, it will do the job. Like, it's better to have less work but good one than a lot of work and maybe like not that good one, and like a mix of everything. Like, always put the best that you do in first on your portfolio.
Do you think I know this is it's probably a crazy question to ask, but do you like, when it comes to like people ask like how many images is like a good amount, is like for example, like, is like there like a sort of like a good kind of like number to kind of keep below, maybe like I don't know, 15 images, 10 images for a lighting artist? I'm not sure if anything's come up that you've learned.
I'm not in the recruitment side of the lighting artist team, but
yeah.
I mean, if you just have a lot of killing project, just put everything. But make sure that the first one we see when we look at your portfolio, maybe like not four artwork during sunset, for example, because it's too much the same thing. But just keeping in mind that what I'm doing, for example, when I look at portfolios on ArtStation, is that I look the four or five first projects, and if those one get my interest, I will look everything.
But it was just the fact that it's like, when you think about it, it's just the fact that it's like you only have a few seconds to see it.
Yeah. This is the thing. Like, yeah, the recruitment team will not have 1 hour to spend. They will just go see everything first, and then they will go by detail on the first artwork, and that's it.
What's your So this is like another thing I was just thinking when it comes to like portfolio and stuff, because I always think keeping it simple is very important, in the sense that for example, do you like there's common themes when it comes to lighting? Like, for example, like you've got I guess the main ones is like obviously like weather. So like when you're doing like a portfolio, maybe like highlighting, like you said, like certain time of day, how does it interact with the environment? It's like, so for example, you've got like the coolest snow environment I've ever seen in my life. So you've got like a snow environment, you've got like maybe in a forest somehow, and you've got like maybe it's at night, like all these different scenes. Do you think it's like, well, what's the best way to phrase it? Well, it's just like, I guess it's just important to keep things simple, and maybe have like a pattern sometimes. But I understand, like, obviously you don't want to have any limitations away from your creativity. Like, it's obviously you want to explore different things, but I'm not sure what your thoughts are keeping it simple. Do you think that's a good idea?
You mean to keep the artwork simple and not go in deep?
Trying to, like, when it comes to getting a job early on, like trying not to be like too extreme, if you know what I mean.
If you want to apply to a job, you have to I think you have to put like everything you know in the artwork. So you show that you understand different stuff, and I think that making artwork that are working, how can I say it? It's quite complicated. Like,
yeah, it's not easy.
If you look for a job, you have to show that you understand a lot of stuff for environment, for example, or even for lighting.
Mm-hmm.
You have to understand that. You have to show that you understand, the basic of the discipline. And I think it's quite important to show a lot of progress. Like if you put your artwork, the final artwork,
mm-hmm.
it's okay because we see the final, but I think it's also important to break down a little bit everything, like in the description, for example, to tell us how you work on this, or to put screenshot of your light rig or something like this.
Yeah,
it's always good for us to see how you work, because we understand what you are doing.
Definitely, like it'd be great if like obviously the whole topic of, like, for example, like student education. It'd be great if, like, say, they're bringing in people from industry and stuff. It'd be really nice to see somebody, like, just for example, what you're doing just now, like the fact that you've like this is so insightful, like so helpful, because like so many students are like asking all these questions, and like they shouldn't have to ask them when they finish uni, you know what I mean? And
yeah.
Or education, and it'd be great if like even like what you just said there, like that's a small thing. Like I used to overestimate it, but do you know, like when you just said there about the description? Like that's so important. Like so many people, like for example, a kind of pet peeve of mine is when people post artwork and they've not made it all, and they've not like maybe included other artists. That, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like it's those small things. Like I'm not sure if there's like anything else about description you want to say, but that's a really good point.
Well, like the thing is that in the description you have to, because it's also something that you will read quite fast,
mm-hmm.
but you have to put highlights on stuff and like short description of your work and short description on how you did it.
Yeah.
And then when you post your pictures, we will understand, like, okay, this is lighting only view something. This is the light rig, and it will be enough.
Yeah, no, that's amazing, because when it comes to like for example, when I was at university, so one of my good friends, he's just got a job as a lighting artist, literally just recently, but he was the only person out of no joke, I think it was like 3 years of students that went into lighting art. I think it's still quite a small niche, in the sense that like a lot of people are still like exploring into it, if you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Okay, it'd be great if that's why I've been bringing on lots of lighting artists, because like I love lighting. Like I think it kind of, it's the one thing that makes or breaks everything. And it's so powerful, and I just wish student education really brought, I guess, more knowledge about it. Like I guess, like the kind of obvious one or that they slightly bring in is like, do you know, when people are maybe doing like master studies, painting and stuff, and they're trying to understand how lighting hits, and that, but that's nothing really that's going to really propel, I guess, the interest forward for games, if that makes sense.
Yeah, the thing is that lighting is kind of a new area mm-hmm. in games, because, for example, when I was in school, there was no or at least really few lighting artists mm-hmm. in video games. And with all the expansion of PBR, of physically based rendering, lighting, this particular role began really important, and I think that I will speak for the school in France, because I know those ones,
mm-hmm.
but I think they began to understand that lighting is an important field, and like to when they show the student creation and artwork, they understand that lighting is a really important thing when they show this.
Yeah.
So I think right now there is an understanding of the importance of this, and it's really good, because a lot of schools now have proper lighting artists, speakers or teacher, and I think it's a really good point.
Yeah, like it's one thing is like Like, not only it makes everything cinematic, if you know what I mean, it really gives the story. It gives story. It gives, it's so, like, you can do everything with lighting. It has such a power behind it that when people underestimate it, and you can clearly tell in people's portfolio, like, for example, I'm a culprit myself in my early work, in some of my recent work. Like, I've improved a lot, but I'm still, like, there's still a long way to go, if you know what I mean.
But I mean, the thing is that it's a long learning. Mm-hmm. Like, for just to tell you, like, I'm still learning new things, and like recently I have a talk with some lighting guys. Mm-hmm. And I'm still learning new things, and this is the best part of this.
That's the part that also makes it fun, if you know what I mean. I guess like being an artist is like, do you, when you're at 18, you're just like sketched away, you're like, I've still got a long way to go. you just never stop learning. It's the same, obviously, for example, one of my main passions is sport, but mm-hmm. sport has its limitations as you get older. unfortunately, if I was playing, well, I get it. Maybe it doesn't apply to my dad. Like, my dad's really good at football, and my whole family's very football orientated, and it's like, my dad's now, 55, and I'm like, he can still kick my ass at football. I'm just like, it's like, he's like running. I'm like, this dude doesn't even do running anymore. It's like, this is not right. This is biased. I don't like it. But like, there's one question that I've never asked before, and it'd be this is another probably difficult one, but it's kind of I think it'd be good to kind of maybe highlight to like the juniors or the beginners. And mm-hmm. it was like, is there anything you've noticed that kind of separates a senior artist or like a mid artist to a junior? Like, what was, like, I know it's probably also kind of an obvious one, but is there anything that you kind of maybe noticed that's kind of like, oh, you can tell the difference?
Yeah. Well, the picture I like to use for this is the final art of a senior and a junior lighting artist should be more or less the same. Like, both of them will go for the same render. Like, I mean, if you take one project and you give it to one senior and one junior, they will end up having the same quality in the artwork. The only difference is the speed the time it will take for them to get to this final art. Like, a senior will know more things to go faster for the same result as a junior that will maybe take more time to do it. Mm-hmm. This is working with junior, this is the only thing that I saw. Like, in the lighting arts, if you have the knowledge of this, it's just a matter of the time.
Of time and speed.
Time and speed for the artwork.
I did not expect that answer, but it makes sense now when I think about it. Because like obviously when it comes to just art in general, I was going to say I thought you were going to be like, it's something to do like maybe like some sort of really, I don't know, complicated artistic vision or something. I don't know. I was not. No, that's really good to hear. That's nice to hear as well, because a lot of artists will be thinking that kind of question. If you know what I mean? Like, if you know what I mean? Like, people are always like trying to compare themselves to like other people all the time.
Oh, yeah. Well, this is like comparing your work to someone else is at the same time good, because you will take this person as an objective and mm-hmm. you will try to reach this objective, but also don't be, I think also, like, I still get into this, but I think Onian speak about this also, but it's like, don't be jealous mm-hmm. of someone's work, because it's not leading to anything good. Yeah. Like, you have to take if someone do something better than you, it's like, okay, he's better, but why is it better?
Mm-hmm.
And you have to understand this and to try yourself to be at the same level or better. It's not a matter of saying, well, he's better and, well, I will never be better than him. It's like, no, you have to think why and go for it.
Yeah. No, one of the best things I like about doing this podcast is when artists say the same thing. Like, so when I'm doing podcasts and things are getting like told the same amount of times, or how am I saying this? When the same thing is repeatedly said, that is one of the best things to hear, because it really digs in, it really highlights to the listeners, the artists who are listening, about, right, it's everyone's saying it, so you just, and it's obvious as well, it's like, you should be having fun with art. Like, it shouldn't be, like, I understand, obviously we all want jobs and stuff, and jobs, you need a job to live, but the healthiest way to grow and improve is by helping each other, and not being jealous, like you said.
Yeah. And the also the thing that can help is that, I mean, we are all busy,
mm-hmm.
but you can, like, if you have, for example, if you are working on the project and you want advice, you can still ask the artist, like, how did you manage to do this, or how did you manage to have this render? And even if we don't have the correct time to answer you,
mm-hmm.
I mean, we saw it, and maybe we will, like, I mean, in for me, for example, when people ask me questions, I try to answer as most as possible.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's hard because you are in a rush or something.
Mm-hmm.
But in general, artists are quite happy to share experience and workflow and everything. It's like there is no like secret thing that we pass to each other only for lighting and everything. There is no such things as this. It's like just sharing, and you just have to train after that.
Yeah, it's like, I think so many students still think it's like, oh, he's hiding that top secret button over there that turns that lighting into gold. They're like, tell me all your knowledge.
But yeah, exactly. Like, there is no secret process that makes everything beautiful.
Oh, it's so funny, because it's like the one thing though I did struggle though with at times, like when I was studying, it's like. Like, do you know if there was something that you saw someone do and it's like so epic and they wouldn't tell you? I was like, oh my gosh, I got heated. I was like, please tell me. Like, it's like, it's not hard just to say.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, it doesn't, like, I just don't get the mindset of people who just aren't willing to, like, I understand maybe that, like, one of the important things for maybe some people, that I guess this point that we're bringing up maybe is important. Like, do you know when the people sometimes are like fighting for a job or something, or they're trying to keep an edge, maybe for like a type of film or whatever they're making? Like, maybe they need to kind of keep certain things behind, if that makes sense, like their style. But I think, like, for example, I was listening to a video the other day, the day before, and one of the, I think, biggest things that too many artists bring up or keep saying that is required, that I personally think isn't, is style. Like, I don't think, like, when it comes to, like, I don't think you, have you ever been asked to create your own lighting style before?
No.
Exactly. So, like, I don't think it's a, like, it's,
yeah, because
it's not a must.
I mean, yeah, it's defined by the art direction, but, like, You can have different style in the global environment or direction and everything, but mm-hmm. they will not ask you to like do crazy stuff. Like,
it's,
I mean,
yeah, it's like the small. There's no, they're not going to be like, I need. Well, I don't even. Like, how do you even create a style with lighting? Is that possible? Like, I understand you can create, like, obviously, like, a certain mood and stuff, but it must be really hard to create a style with lighting.
It's a lot of work, a lot of tries. Like, I can't tell you how many projects I have in my Unreal folder that are just garbage. And it's a lot of tries, a lot of fails. And for young artists, for example, it's not a bad thing to fail something because you will learn. Like, it's something that everyone said, but it's really important to understand that sometimes a project is just meant to be a test for you, and you will learn stuff to not do or to do for your next project. Like, it will make your life easier. And in terms of style, what I like to do, like, there is only, I think, one thing that I like to do when I begin a project is always begin to work with black and white
Oh,
to
okay.
create contrast. Like, this is something that I like to try. And then when I have a good contrast in my black and white picture, I begin to work with colors.
That's cool. I was then that's an awesome perspective, because like when you're working black and white, you learn so much, and no, that's cool, because when it comes to like lighting and stuff, like obviously I still consider myself like personally I consider myself obviously like a rookie when it comes to lighting, in the sense that like I don't I honestly like obviously I have like I feel like I've said it in one of the podcasts, like I feel I have a I think it was in Ognian's podcast, like I feel like I understand what I have to like kind of like aim for, if that makes sense, but it's like learning that approach to like how do I do it, or how do I develop it, like learning like the ways to actually not just only understand it but actually like master it. And it's if like for example, if you're saying like through understanding contrast is like your way to develop something fresh, then everyone who's listening really maybe start like take on that advice and explore give that a go.
And
Yeah, on you go.
sorry, like the thing that we were talking earlier is the not lit everything at the same intensity, for example. Like, contrast is really important because it will give this feeling that you want to create something in a scene. Like, if you have really dark scene, using contrast is really good. And also, what something that I saw a lot in student work is that they, for outdoor environment, for example, they lit everything with the directional light in Unreal. And one of the thing I learned also is that sometimes you don't want the directional light to be your main light source. You can use spotlight, different spotlight. And then doing this, because directional light is good, but it lights everything at the same intensity. So you have like a flat intensity of lighting. And using spotlights, you will be able to control the intensity of different spotlight and then create this. Like, if you want to focus on something, you will increase the intensity in one direction and decrease in the other one, but you will still keep lighting in those area. And it's a good way to guide the eye of the people that will look at your work. And it's also a good thing to, like, put some area more in the how to say that?
Like in this, in like make it sort of
Like,
in the spotlight.
yeah, making this more pop up in your work.
Awesome. So like, can give it more of like a focal point.
Yeah, exactly.
That makes sense. No, because I liked what you said there about like what you said about the changing it up, because obviously everyone has like a natural habit of having like that one main source. Like I definitely was a culprit when I did when I made my train scene, because like I was. Then again, well, I had my reasons for it, because I was really going for like obviously like the composition. I was really trying to guide my train as the focal point, and I really wanted to sell. Like, the main thing for me was always scale and trying to try and get. It's like what you're saying earlier about, do you know, like when you were going through the scene with a camera and trying to see what works for you? So, like, that's what I was trying to do as well. In a sense, like, obviously nowhere near your ability, but I was trying to, like, try to figure out what kind of worked and what clicked and stuff. But it's important to change things up, and like I what you said there, like, I kind of, like, learned that the hard way through lighting, because it was weird. So when I was doing my lighting scene, I had a mistake of using too many lights, and I ended up realizing that the best thing for me to do, so I literally deleted everything. So I deleted about, like, I'm not sure if this is going to be a bad thing when you hear this, but I had like 50, like, I have no idea how many lights are using the game, but I had like 50 lights for this one shot, and then I narrowed it down to 4.
50?
Yeah, I had... is that a good, or is what's considered too many lights? I have no idea.
Well, it depends, because if you have, you can have 50 lights, but not with the same radius, I guess. Because sometimes you want to highlight some area, and if you have a fixed image, 50 lights is not, like, I mean, it's okay, but you have to work with the radius and highlight some area of the environment.
Yeah.
Like, what I like to do when I find my camera spot, for example, and I say, okay, I will not move this, I still try to compose the lighting with the rim light, the front light, and everything. And then doing this, you will increase the amount of light. But I mean, if it's for a fixed image, and let's say that you are baking, it's fine. Like, it's okay to have many lights. In video games, you will be restricted, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But there is still some solution, like, as I said, light with really small radius that will not interfere with other lights, for example. And if everything is baked, it's fine. So, I mean, there is solution to add lights. And I think there is also the opposite. Like, what I like to do in outdoors environment is to put as less as light as possible.
Okay.
Like, I always try to have one skylight if it's outdoor, and spotlights or directional lights to create my sunlight, and then just few lights to highlight the part that I want.
So as you, like, your main sort of main area of interest again?
Yeah.
Awesome. No, because, like, that's like I said, so, like, when I was like, the main reason why I want to continue this topic of discussion is because I still think there's a lot of it makes sense why they do it. So every beginner artist, or people who are maybe new to lighting and stuff, obviously, like, they're exploring things, like, they tend to, like, put lights everywhere, but they don't necessarily understand, like, why they're putting it there. And that's why I've always had so much praise and value for truly understanding the theory, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Because, like...
Normally you put light where you have something that emits light. You do not... I mean, if your scene is correctly set up and everything, your GI will cover the dark area.
Yeah.
But if you find that one area is really dark, you have in you want to put a light in this, you have to, well, in, for me, it's not, I don't know if everyone is working like this, but for me, you have to have a light source. You can have area lights that are only here for let's say simulate GI, but I like to use just like light that are in the scene.
Definitely. No, that's great. Thank you so much for going into depth about that, because I think so many people are missing out on all these small things, if you know what I mean. And it's crucial to hear about, like, especially coming from you, like, hearing like, how you work, what's your thought process, and, like, how you break down a shot for as a lighting artist. It's like there's so many things that so many students can take like so much value from this. And guys, if you're tuning in, make the most of it while you can, because when it comes to getting like obviously I preach it all the time, like ask questions, fire people, information and stuff, and help each other out as much as possible. I do have one last question before we finish the podcast. It'd be really cool to hear. So when it comes to the podcast, one of the main things is like university and online courses, and talk about them both and stuff. However, the main thing I would like to ask is like the online side of things. When it comes to you as a lighting artist, what's the main sort of go-to sources that you've found over the years that's benefited you?
You mean the...
like the teaching aspect, or like what sort of like helped you improve basically?
As a teacher, you mean?
So like when it comes to you learning how to become a better lighting artist, like what sort like websites and stuff do you use basically?
Oh, okay. Sorry, I didn't understand.
It's okay. Sorry.
I know that there is a lot of good online training websites, like CGMA or I don't remember. Yeah, CGMA is the one that I think I see the most in the student research.
Good, nice.
And I mean, I never had the chance to follow one of those courses.
Okay.
But for sure, it's also something to take in account that, for example, if you are in a studio and you have to update yourself, the studio will maybe sometimes provide you some classes. And you can get some online classes also.
Definitely.
Like, this is a good... I mean, the online classes, the best advantage that you have is that you can have insane teachers, like from Naughty Dog, from Ubisoft, anywhere, and they don't have to move. Like, they are at home, they teach you, and it's the best way. Like, having the best teacher in the world teaching you is like crazy.
It makes it so cool and more fun. It just makes it more valuable, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And then the last thing I want to mention up is, it's actually something you mentioned really early on. It's the importance of books.
Yeah.
Like, I think still too many students have begun to maybe overlook books, or like they still rely so much. Like, I understand it's like using the internet is great and stuff, but there's still like I understand you can get books on the internet. Like, but obviously, there's a lot of value in books and like researching books and stuff, and like making sure to actually like understand the theory. Like I keep saying, like I'll keep repeating it, because it's a lot of people, for example, if you're doing lighting or if you're doing character, or like a lot of people need to start doing more anatomy studies. Like there's all these things that for the theory side of things that naturally just propels your artwork in the right direction.
Yeah.
No, but thank you so much for coming on. This would be a great podcast. I've learned a tremendous amount, and it's things like that are so crucial.
Thank you, man, for the invite. It was really, really nice to speak with you.
Anytime. No, it really means a lot. Once again, folks, so the main thing when it comes to the podcast is obviously the guests. So I'm going to put obviously his artwork everywhere, all in the background right now. It's going to be shared everywhere. So please make sure to go give him a follow. You've got 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Make sure to give him a follow. make the most of it, because when it comes to artists, there's so many great artists out there that you can learn from, and he's definitely one of them. So make sure to give him a follow, leave a like and so forth on his artwork. So you use Twitter, don't you? So it's Twitter. Do you use Instagram?
Yeah, but I do not post like a lot of stuff on Instagram.
No, it's okay. I always ask just in case, because I realize that I realize I'm beginning to say the same thing at the end of every podcast. Every artist is using Twitter and ArtStation, nothing else, pretty much.
As long as
you've got those two, like, I guess that's another thing when it comes to just arts in general. Make sure you have a Twitter and an ArtStation, then you're sorted for life.
Yeah.
Like, there's nothing really else you need. So, once again, folks, make sure to give them a follow. If you enjoyed today's episode, please leave a like. That'll be much appreciated. Don't forget to subscribe. Make sure to select the notification bell to be notified every single week. I've actually got more news for everyone who's listening. So if you've got to the podcast, got to hear so far, that's super awesome. But I think I've got another crazy week for you guys next week. So stay tuned. I've got our first texture artist coming on next week. And hopefully you've got one of my best friends coming on to talk about something very interesting. And I've got a few more environment artists coming on. So lots of content. And then I've got another podcast in 2 hours' time. So keep tuning in, and we will see you guys in the next video. Bye for now.